we can have Joseph studies in connection with the church and the believers. It is almost altogether different study compared to what is for the servants of God. And one thing that is really encouraging my heart is that because the coming of the Lord is very near, God wants that we all to become like Jesus. And I very much feel that study, the Lord tarries, will really greatly help us. Because in so many ways, Joseph is a type of Jesus. And as some time ago we had the Daniel study, once in a we had tests also. So that will help us to listen also carefully. And I don't know after the test whether the adults will get any prize, but I want to encourage the children will get prize if they listen properly and write when the test comes. Shall we have a word of prayer once again? Father, these studies, series, Lord, we do not know whether we will finish it. Perhaps before that you will come. Or perhaps, Lord, you will call us to eternal glory. In either case, O God, help us, Lord, always to live in the readiness of your coming. In Jesus' name. In the Old Testament, perhaps, unlike anybody else, Joseph is a type of Jesus. We know Jesus was hated by his brethren. And Joseph also was hated by his brethren. And we find that when Jesus was punished, along with him there were two people on either side hanging. So also when Joseph was punished and put in the pit or in the prison, there were two with him. And out of the two, we find about Jesus, one saved. One was saved and the other perished. And with Joseph also, out of the two, one was hanged. The baker was hanged and the butler was saved. And before Joseph was put in the pit, his clothes was taken from him. Jesus also, before he was punished and put on the cross, his clothes also were removed from him. Like that, there are so many similarities. In fact, there may not be any other character in the Bible who is so much a type of parallel to Jesus as Joseph. Now we will straight away go to first place that we read about anything that Joseph doing, that is in the 37th chapter. From the 37th chapter we find, except 38th chapter, all over we find Joseph. And we will read the second verse, 37:2. These are the generations of Jacob. Joseph, being 17 years old, was feeding the flock with his brethren, and the lad was with the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. And Joseph brought unto his father their evil report. Here about in the second chapter, second verse, we read something beautiful. In fact, as we go and study in the further verses, we'll find very, very exciting things. By the way, this study is purely for our character building. May not be very much scientific or theological or any other, you know, studies which may be mostly for our brain knowledge. It will really build up our spiritual life and character. If there is some little change in my character is there, there is a long way to go in my life, but that is through the study of Joseph. Now, some people get discouraged about their background. They say, my background is not good. My, you know, parents are, or family is not very good, and they, my upbringing was not good, my father was not a good example, my mother was not a good example, my brothers and sisters were not very good. So that is hindering my spiritual life, some people say. Now what do you think about Joseph? If you ask Joseph, Joseph, what is your father's name? My father's name is Mr. Deceiver. What? Yes, his name was Mr. Deceiver. How did he get? He has been deceiving all along. He deceived his father and putting, disguised himself to the elder brother and got, and he deceived his father-in-law, Laban, and he deceived his own brother, Esau. All along he has been a deceiver. How many wives your father had? I remember four, but I don't know whether out of these four children were brought up. Four wives your father had. I see. Is it one after the other after divorcing? No, at a time. That is your father's background. What about your mother? Mother was Mrs. Deceiver. What? Yes, she deceived and she had stolen her father's idols. And she was an idol worshiper, and she was a liar also. When the father came and asked, did you take the idols? She was very cunning. Some people may steal, but they don't know how to cover it up. But my mother knew how to steal and to cover it up. I see. This is the background of, about, give some details about your brothers and sisters. Yes, I had a sister, but she fell into immorality. Dinah was her name. And what about brothers? Brothers, two became terrible murderers. What are the names of those two brothers? Simeon and Levi. They simply didn't kill. They just went and butchered everybody in the city. What is the name of the city? Shechem. They went and killed everybody. And the other brothers, I have no time to go through all the, what even the very father says about this. Joseph's brothers, they were terrible. So remember, dear children of God, you don't need to be discouraged thinking about your family background. If at all you think about family background, Joseph's family background was terribly bad. Terrible. And Rachel died on the way. And she had her idols with her. She was really pagan. And with all four wives and all of them having children, and God very strictly told her against polygamy. So none of these things became a hindrance for him to become a saint. Maybe your father's background and your mother's background, your brothers and sisters' background may be not very good. But don't be discouraged about it. The grace of God does not go through royal family or anything that is connected with any morality. The grace of God flows through how we are receptive to the grace of God. And now another thing about him that we find. If God really wants to make you a saint, what will God do? There is a great possibility the people, those who are working with you, God will give you terrible people in your working place to work with you. Do you find that problem now? The people who are working in your office or workplace, terrible type of people God will give to work with you. Why God gives that? Arrogant or people, those who are stubborn and selfish, angry and terrible. What type of people he had? Now Joseph will read the second verse. What did we read? Somebody else also may read that verse. 37:2. As you know, in the dear children of God, in the Bible, there is nothing written unnecessarily. So, here we read, Joseph was working, feeding the flock, with whom? With the sons of Bilhah and with the sons of Zilpah, his father's wives. So, what type of people were there? These Bilhah's sons and Zilpah's sons? About Bilhah's son Dan. One is Dan, Bilhah's son. about him, you know what? His own father says, what type of man was Dan? Please read Genesis 49 verse 17. 49:17.
Dan shall be a serpent by the way.
Dan is a serpent by the way, and
an adder in the path.
And he is an adder in the path.
That biteth the horse heels.
Yeah, Dan was a biting serpent. Would you like to? Do you have some people working with you, like biting serpent? Whenever they open the mouth, they give out filth. And why God allows you to work with such people? Is it because God hates you? And then we read about, at least one son will read about Silpa's son, Gad. One son was Silpa's son was Gad. Let us read about him. Deuteronomy chapter 33 verse 20. Anybody who has taken, if you could quickly read, then we can go on. This shows why God is allowing such people to work with us. 33:20. Here we read, he is a tearing lion. Who says? This is, earlier it was the words of his own father. This is the servant of God, Moses says. So one is a biting serpent, the other is a tearing lion. Do you have some people work with you, tearing lion? Very boisterous and hot-tempered. They will be roaring all the time at you. Maybe your boss may be like a tearing lion. Maybe somebody working with you may be biting serpent. So here we find this 17-year-old boy was working with Silpa's children and Bilhah's children. You know why God allowed that? People to work with you. What is the reason? To make you a saint. If you work all over, everybody who is working with you is a saint, you will never become a saint. Your anger, impatience, pride, they are not put to test. But these people, when they are working with you, we find Joseph was working with Bilhah's children and Silpa's children. That is what the word of God says. And when he gets home, the other brothers were there. Who are the others? That Leah's children also. And we find Leah's children, as we know about, two of them are Simeon and Levi. They are, Bible says, their anger was very cruel. Very angry people. And also they were murderous people. And about somebody else we read about who was like a donkey, about Issachar we read. So listen here, when he goes to work, tearing lion and biting serpent, when he comes home, there are Levi and Simeon and Issachar and all others who are like strong donkeys. Issachar was, and Levi and Simeon, murderous people. So it was like a, you know, you have heard about crash courses, you also may have here in the States. When 3 years or 4 years of course, within 1 or 2 years you can finish, that is, you call it crash course. Maybe 1 year's course, in 3 months they say you have to, so much to study within that time. It will be a crash course, say maybe 3 years course if you win, it can be a crash course 1 year, then you get the degree. So here, obviously Joseph was in a crash course. He, when he goes to work, serpents, adder, and lion were there to work with him. And when he comes home, these murderous people and the strong donkey type of people were there. And everywhere he was pushed and pulled and squeezed. And why it was done? God quickly wanted to make him a saint. So I have good news for you. When you come home, you find people also really cruel and angry and always very hard type of people you can work with. And when you go to work also, you find a terrible situation. That means you are going through a crash course to make you quickly a saint, because there is not much time spent left, you know. God wants to make you, make you and me like here in the modern world. We find everything is instant. Instant coffee, instant tea, instant. So everything is instant. So to some extent, I would say, of course, you cannot become an instant saint anyway. But you can have a crash course where when you come home, you will find your nagging wife or hot-tempered husband. Or when you go to work also, you will find similar situations. Joseph was placed in that situation. God was testing whether he will become bitter against them, whether he is going to get hatred against them. God was really testing. But we find he came out in flying colors. But some of us, dear children of God, when God will put us into such a test in your working place and the place at home, in every day, the people with whom you are living, whether husband or wife or children or parents, there will be situations where you can have so much of clash. But you and I should know, God has placed this type of people there to change our character quickly and make us saints. This is what God has done in Joseph. Nobody is born as a saint. But we should know why God has permitted some people in our working place or at home. God has placed us. But naturally we can become bitter, angry against them and hate them and speak against them. And we may do so much of things and we get irritable and resentful. Then you fail in the school of God. So many people are failing in the school of God. We don't realize why God allows. This is the first place in the Bible that we find about Joseph, anything about Joseph's life. Here, he had to work with all these people. Why God allowed? He was 17-year-old boy. He was the son of old age. Joseph's father, Jacob, that time, he was about 107 or 108 that time. So he was born when his father was about 90 or 91. He was like a grandchild or a great-grandchild that age. But there, father allowed him. We know about Jacob. He had many servants at home. So many servants he had. But still father sent him to work there with this Zilpah's children and Bilhah's children. So it may appear as if his father was very cruel to him. Why should a 17-year-old boy has to go to work when there are so many servants at home? And he was very rich. Jacob, we read, he was very, very rich. So sometimes our Heavenly Father will allow us to work in situations and surroundings where we can even get bitter against God. But what lesson we learn from here, the lesson that we learn from here is that if God is influencing our life, nothing around us can influence us. I hope we all will learn that lesson. If God does not influence us, wherever we go, we will get like the chameleon when we change the color. We will get adjusted to the people. There is a saying, when you are in Rome, you be a Roman. That is not the way of God. Here, Joseph was put in that state. He didn't become like them. Hating, cruel, murderous, immoral, selfish, envious, he didn't become. So God will put you and me in situations to see whether we are changing our character there. It's very easy we can get. If God is influencing our life, no person, no nothing, no circumstances, no place can influence us. But if God is not of the greatest influence, we get quickly changed. That shows there is no maturity in our life. When there is a real maturity, look at Daniel. He was put, we read about Daniel last year, Sometime he was about 14 or 15 or at the most 16. Here at least Joseph was 17. When he was put in a place of Babylon full of drinks and so many things were provided, and that too freely. But that didn't influence Daniel. Daniel was only influenced by God. We read about, there are, can you tell somebody else in the Bible who was not influenced by anything? Samuel. When he was as a small boy, he was placed with Eli's children. Eli's children were immoral children. Terrible life they lived. But that did not influence. So what we learn, if we really want to become truly, to grow to be like Jesus, God will permit people in our working place, in our house, to change our character. What they are doing, they are, some people may be like serpents, some people like adder, is poison, some people will be like tearing lions, some people will be like strong donkeys, and some people have, there are so many other things are mentioned. It is to change us and to make us like Jesus. But if we get upset with those people and angry with those people, and if we cannot get on with them, then we failed in the class. Our character cannot be changed. God's purpose cannot be. God had a great plan and purpose for Joseph. God has got a plan and purpose about your life and my life. To mold our character and change, God allows all these types of situations of people to be around us. How are we going to deal with that? Here we find Joseph, really, he came out in flying colors, so to say. And then we find he was, one thing that he was doing, he was bringing evil report to his father. As you know that, we have, from the beginning of study, you will keep in mind, very often we will be keeping Joseph as a type of Jesus. Then Joseph's father will be like our heavenly father. Because he brought evil report to his father about the things of what his brothers had done, we read Joseph's brothers hated him. And the same fact we read about Jesus also. John 7:7. We read the same thing. Because people hated Jesus because he testified against the evil of others. John 7:7. Because I testify that what they are doing is evil, what are they doing against me? They are hating me. So we don't need to go to somebody and give evil report of others. That will be backbiting. As Joseph did, we can go to our heavenly father and report it. Are we doing that? Backbiting is that instead of going to the right person, go to the wrong person and speak. That is called backbiting. You and I, we all are, at least once in a way, guilty of that. What he did, he went to his father and gave the evil report. And the second verse that we find, when he was 17, he was feeding the flock. When we are, what is the meaning of feeding the flock? Looking after souls, that isn't it? So when we are young and tender, that is the best time to make proper commitment of our life. I hope all the young people will also listen. When we are young and tender, that is the best time to make the right type of commitment, right type of consecration to make. The older you get, the harder you become. The younger you are, the better you are. Character can be molded. Older people, changing is extremely difficult because their habits are set. Their character mostly set, like the clay after dried up. Even if you break, it doesn't, you cannot change it as you like. So Joseph did that. We read in the Bible, God never called out to serve God anybody who is lazy. Or we read everywhere people were working. Elisha was plowing the field, then called. Moses, David, they were feeding the flock. And we read in the New Testament also, that a good number of disciples, they were fishing when Jesus called. Matthew was in the tax office and Gideon was threshing wheat. So it is people who are really willing and working, the Lord called. And this spirit, we should get it when we are young. As you know, idle mind is devil's workshop. God wants that we may, as word of God says, occupy till I come. God doesn't want lazy people. Then who wants lazy people? Who wants lazy people? Devil wants lazy people. When lazy, that is the time the devil can tempt. David was lazy one day, his afternoon, when the battle was going on, and the battlefield all were there, that he was lazy in the afternoon and he was still in bed. And then the devil tempted him. And he fell, we know how he fell into sin. Devil wants lazy people. So laziness is definitely is enemy of God's grace. We can lose out. Here, Joseph was feeding the flock. We need to keep our life really occupied. Occupied how long? Till he comes. That is why every failure, whether we are not reading the Bible or not praying, most of our failures are because of laziness. You might have heard, Brother Rene was speaking about it at length. Quite often that we become irresponsible, untidy, and there are so many things which God wants you and I to do. We don't do or delay to do because of laziness. But we find Joseph a different person altogether. And how? Maybe in the coming days we will learn how he made use of God-given time. And when we come to the third and fourth verse, Genesis 37, 3 and 4, if somebody can here find, they started, Joseph's brothers started hating him. And the reason was that he was the father's beloved. Joseph was, like Jesus was father's beloved. And Joseph was the father's beloved. And that was the reason they started hating him. Hatred, look here, Joseph could have hated them because they were terrible people. What all, word of God said he brought evil report to the father. That means so many wrong things they might have been doing. And perhaps they might have been treating also Joseph very badly. But we don't find Joseph hating his brothers. But we find Joseph's brother Anna hating Joseph. When hatred comes, we know our calling stops there. The work of God finished there. No more God can do any work in our life. You may be sometimes inwardly hating your wife or hating your husband. You children may be hating your father, hating your mother, or brother or sister. When hatred comes, then the work God cannot do any more work in your life. That we find here about Joseph, Joseph's brothers. First thing that we find, they lost the peace. Joseph's brothers didn't have any peace. When hatred comes into our heart, how do we know? We don't have any peace. How do we know that Joseph's brothers didn't have any peace? Anybody can say? That's right. They couldn't speak a word peaceably to him. The verse that we read, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. So when you hate somebody, you are going to lose your peace. That person is not going to. We don't find Joseph ever losing his peace. But Joseph's brothers lost their peace. When you hate somebody, you know that. You don't have any peace, any inner peace in your heart. That means you have hatred against somebody. When you are hating somebody, you are hating God, isn't it? When you hate your brother, Bible says you are hating your God. Anything that you are doing against a brother or sister, you are doing against God. When Saul was persecuting only Christians, but what did God say? What did God say? Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Saul could have told, I didn't persecute you. I only persecuted Christians. But when you are hating somebody, what are you doing? You are hating God. This is what happened to these brothers. It is a very sad story about these brothers. This story of Joseph's brothers is a good lesson for anyone seated here. If you hate anybody, if you hate anyone, you know how your end will be. Your end will be like Joseph's brother's end. Finally, they became a liability. They became a burden to Joseph. And not only Joseph's brother, even his family finally told, I will look after you and care for you and feed you. Listen, when you hate somebody, you are going to become a liability for others. Your life is going to become a burden for others, not a blessing. And your end cannot be better than Joseph's brother's end. By hating somebody, for some time you think that you are enjoying it. Yes, so and so did that thing and that person is so ungrateful and so bad. I try to be good and kind and caring, but that person is like a biting serpent and a tearing lion and strong ass, and there are so many things are mentioned about it. But when once hatred, why hatred is coming? What is the reason the hatred is coming in our heart? Not because so and so has done something against us. Hatred comes because we don't have love in our heart. Love covereth the multitude of sins. When love is, it shows how shallow is our love. If somebody is coming to beat you or and speak against you, immediately if you get hatred against that, not because that person is trying to do something against you that you got hatred. Your heart was very shallow in God's love. That is why sometimes God permits some people to pick on us to see how far we have got the depth of love in our heart. So one lesson that I told was that once we start hating someone or we lose peace of mind. Another thing, whatever God planned for your life and that stopped there. And finally we read, we become a burden for others. What happened with Joseph's brothers? Finally, Joseph's brothers were in great famine. They were famine stricken, almost dying. Joseph called them, come, I will feed you. And your little ones also I will feed. What does it mean? If we hate someone, you are going to become a burden for others. Sometimes even to the very person whom we are hating, we may become a burden. Therefore, I request you, never hate anyone. Whatever reason that you think that you keep bitterness and hatred against someone, you are going to lose out a lot. That is not the only two things I mentioned. What are the two things that I mentioned? If you keep hatred in your heart, what are the two things? One is you lose your peace. Another is, loudly, you become a burden for others. You will not be a blessing for others, you will be a burden. And worst thing that I want to tell now, people, those who hate, once we start hating someone, even when God starts blessing us, it will not appear a blessing at all. You know, Bible says, God is sending the rain upon the righteous and the wicked. But when God is blessing us, we will not see the blessing. We cannot find us a blessing. That is the worst part. Even when God is blessing, you will take it as God is cursing you. Can you tell from the brothers, Joseph's brother's story? That, anybody? Anyway, There are a number of places. Those who asked, read the book of Genesis, hands up, then I don't need to go through all that. Once again, all those who read the book of Genesis, hands up, the first book in the Bible. Almost all of you have read, but some, anyway, at least from today, I know, if your name is not in the list, please put your name. Then I know by before the end of this month, you will finish reading Genesis. And so we find Joseph really cared for, Joseph is a type of Jesus. When, I don't want to go into all the verses because it may take time, only just briefly the essential things that I can speak. Perhaps taking too many verses can become a bit of boring to some of us. But it is good to know also. We read, several times Joseph had shown mercy and goodness to them. Twice we read, when Joseph's brothers went to buy corn in the land of Canaan, sorry, in the land of Egypt, when they went from Canaan, Joseph was given the money. But you know what Joseph did? All the money, Joseph told, return to them in the very sacks, in the very shopping bag, put the money also and send away. So Joseph told his stewards, when these people come, fill all their bags with corn and put their money also in that. Joseph wanted to be kind to them. But you know what happened? Halfway through, they opened the sack and they found money. They got really troubled. What wrong has God done against us? Do you think God has done anything wrong? At least that verse we should read. Otherwise, some of you may not realize it's in the Bible. Where do you find? Yes, chapter 42. Before chapter 42, somewhere else. Please help me, those who find it, first read it out. 42:28. Yes, that's right. Somebody may quickly read, please. See, here, God is doing, Joseph was doing something good. But when a person is having hatred in the heart, the good things that God does, they take it as wrong things God has done. See the example, 28th verse. See, what is this God has done? They got back their money. Joseph gave the money back. And what do they say? Say now, God has done something very bad. And what happened to them? They had a sudden heart attack. What do we read? And he said unto his brethren, my money is restored, and lo, it is even in my sack. And their heart failed them. They had a heart failure. What was the reason? The reason was that God was very good to them. That was the reason. Can you imagine? That is written in the Word of God. Listen, dear child of God, carefully. Don't you ever allow bitterness to come into your heart. When bitterness comes into your heart, you cannot discern between good and evil. You will take good as evil. Perhaps you may take evil as good also. This is the example. It's not one example. Next example, let us read. Where do we find again? Same chapter. See, again they were afraid. This is the second time we read. What we find, this is a terrible fact, but I don't think many Christians, they don't realize the cost, the price we have to pay for keeping bitterness, hatred in our heart. Can you imagine what we read in the Bible? When all the money, bundles of money was returned to them, they were terribly afraid. And then started telling everything is going wrong for us. Do you find everything is going wrong for us? The reason is that you are going wrong. That is why you feel everything is going wrong. When I keep on spinning all over, what happens to the world? What happens to the world? The world is spinning. How fast I keep on spinning, that fast the world is spinning. But I don't say I am spinning, I am going round. I blame the world. The world is going, you know, spinning. I could see it. And it is going faster and faster and faster. Dear child of God, that is what hatred. Bitterness makes our spiritual eyes blind. I ask you today, in the first study itself, if you really want it, the Lord tarries, we have any studies here left, first thing that wish, even the good study is given, you will take it as bad. Anything good is happening, you will not realize that is good. And how many, the hatred, the results of hatred, I told, one is you lose peace. Second is that you become a liability or a burden. And what is the third thing? What is the third thing? You count your blessings as curses. The goodness of God you cannot see. The goodness of God you will see only as wrong. Then another thing. Constantly you will be under fear. Not once in a way. Constantly you will be under fear. Something is going to happen. Something wrong is going to happen. We find several times they were afraid. Already we read that they were afraid. Even up to the end, till the last chapter, 50th chapter we read, they were afraid. That fear will never leave us. Now I ask you, is it worth keeping bitterness in our heart? Is it worth keeping hatred in our heart? How many times the hatred word is mentioned here? Once it starts, it just keeps building and building and building. It is like a flood. If you give room for the bitterness or hatred, it will come like flood. So the fourth verse we read, that is 37, 4 we read, and when his brethren saw that their father loved him more than all his brethren, they hated him and could not speak peaceably unto him. And what do we read in the fifth verse? Again we find, hated him yet the more. That means, hatred will be increasing and increasing and increasing. Again that we read,